To the rush hour, this is the special edition of what exactly is happening in the Kenyan. The Kenyan population, 22 million voters, are actually lining up this morning to take their vote and elect their next president. Now, all Vision Group platforms are covering this election live and, of course, bringing you updates of what exactly is taking place. Now, we are going to take you throughout this, from this time to the time to 10 a.m. And, of course, will be our normal programming. Will continue with exactly what is actually happening in Kenya, because these Kenyan elections, we have so many lessons to learn as Ugandans, but also being a member of the East African community, we have to pay much attention to what exactly is taking place in there. I have a panel of experts here, seated here, but also our team, Vivian Kamsime, and of course, Lynn Komjisha, and our different journalists are going to be joining us during the show. We ask the question on our social media platforms, who is taking it? Who do you think is the next president of Kenya? Is it Raila this time or it is Ruto? Join that conversation on our social media platforms at Urban TV Uganda, on Twitter, on Facebook, Urban Television. We'll be reading that comment and of course later in the show. But before we do that, let's first actually connect to Lynn in Studio B to tell us exactly what is happening in this country and whether Uganda is really so much concerned about the election that is taking place in Kenya. Lynn Komjisha, very good morning and welcome to Rush Hour. Please just take us through what exactly is the latest in Uganda and what we have as an alert from the security agencies and other departments of government.
Right. Yes, indeed, Mubarak. Thank you for that. News coming in from Kenya indicate that Deputy President William Ruto has already cast his vote, and so has his running mate. They've cast their vote earlier this morning. We have news coming in as well. But before, after casting his vote, DP Ruto said he is feeling very good and that this vote is definite and will change the destiny of this country. He also voted with, alongside his wife and neighbors, and he was very excited about it. So called on the EBC to exercise its mandate professionally, and thereafter also saw that Raila Odinga's running mate, that is Martha Karua, cast her vote also, and she said that she's looking forward to what the outcome will definitely be. Raila Odinga is set to vote at around 10:30 a.m. later this morning, but voting is going on very peacefully for now. There was concerns that some election materials had to reach areas and insecure areas had not arrived. But then the IEBC said, you know what, we are going to airlift these materials. So people should relax and know that they are going to vote perfectly. So we are following up on what's happening there. Like I said, Ruto's running mate, Geoffrey Rigathi, I beg your pardon, has also cast his vote, and they are calling on for a peaceful and deliberate voting exercise. David Mwaure, this is presidential candidate Wahiga. He has also voted. He has also cast his vote. That's the latest so far that we have. Of course, we'll have more information as it comes on. But joining me, Mubarak, here is Simon Masaba. Simon Masaba is our senior security journalist here at New Vision. Simon, a very good morning and welcome to Rush Hour.
Good morning. Hey.
We understand that elections in our neighborhood really, really play a key role in the day-to-day running of our country.
Sure.
Are there any security concerns as regards this election?
Yeah, the first concern is actually, first we should pray that it's peaceful in Kenya. But again, there's what we call cross-border crime.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the time when the syndicates are very active.
Okay.
Job seekers, people run companies that take people outside Uganda abroad for those what we call the migrant workers.
Yes, yes.
And the companies are not licensed.
Mm-hmm.
So this is their perfect timing to have those people outside this country.
Why is that?
The borders.
Mm-hmm.
There's a bit of laxity.
Ah.
That's why security is on the high alert. Yesterday they kept on announcing.
Yeah, they keep saying they're on high alert. So how prepared are we?
I think they're really prepared.
for anything.
Visibly, but when we moved in today, you could see a lot of deployment. So this goes really across the border and towards the border to just ensure that everything is in check.
How can you and I, you know, calm down? Because the elections are heated up in Kenya, but it seems they're on holiday. We seem to want to take the same holiday here.
I think once you see them on the street, you're sure of safety.
Ah, yeah. They shouldn't scare us.
No, they shouldn't. Once you see them, you just know there's relative peace.
So what else can we look out for?
We should look out for, I think, personal issues like cars.
Mm-hmm.
They're easy to break in, and then they're easy to be taken.
Easy to be taken. Yeah, personal Kenya's, property.
Yeah, personal property, if I may say.
So while the Kenyans and our brothers and sisters across are taking, they're going to the polls, can you be careful with your property? This is when most syndicates, as he says, are very active. Thank you so much, Simon, for that update. Mm-hmm. All right, Mubarak, back to you, and let's see what next happens as we, you know, pick up the latest updates from Kenya.
Thank you so much, Lynn Kumjisha, for that, and of course, Simon Masava, for that wonderful analysis of what exactly we should look out for. And of course, Kenyans are lining up to take their vote in this day, of course. Many, as we have had updates from Lynn, that actually many of the voters are now lining up, and of course some of the presidential candidates and their running mates have taken to the polling stations and cast their vote. Now with me in studio, before actually we get back to Lynn, are two distinguished guests. Now Isaiah Kojang, the chairman of Association of Kenyans in Uganda. We understand that over 1,000 Kenyans are going to be actually taking their votes in the Kenyan High Commission here in Kampala. They are going to exercise their constitutional right. Now we have their chairman here to actually tell us exactly what is going to happen and how this is going to be done. Also, Donald Wasake is a data analyst and, of course, a political analyst, also taking us through what exactly is taking place in Kenya and what we should expect and, of course, what it means for this country. Let me start with you, Isaiah. First of all, a very good morning and welcome to the Rush Hour.
Good morning.
Take us through, what does actually this election mean to you as a Kenyan?
Thank you, Mubarak. And let me confirm that I have voted this morning. And this is a confirmation, this blue indelible ink in between my fingers.
Yes.
I voted at exactly 7:40.
Wow.
And I was told that by that time, about 400 had voted. The polling stations at the Kenya High Commission opened at exactly 6 a.m. And everything is running smoothly. The biometric kits are working. It took me only about 2 minutes on the queue. Then I was in the process of voting. Mm-hmm. And it took me just about 1 minute to finish everything. Mm. So the queues
this
are moving
very,
really
very,
fast.
Very effective.
What does this mean to me as a Kenyan? I think it is a turning point. Mm-hmm. Kenya has been in the process of democratization over the last, I would say, 12 years, mm-hmm. you know, active democratization.
Yes.
We had our new constitution enacted in 2010, mm-hmm. Which brought in a lot of changes, even the way we vote, even the different tiers of government. Mm-hmm. And this is the time that we are seeing that people really appreciate what the constitution brought.
Exactly.
And you have probably monitored the campaigns mm-hmm. and people are talking about issues,
yes.
everybody, from who you would consider as the top contenders mm-hmm. To the rest of them who are down there.
Donald, let me bring in, actually, you here also before I get to Vivian. What does this election mean to you as a Ugandan in the first place? You're not a Kenyan. What does it mean as a Ugandan?
I think the Kenyan election is just one of the most interesting litmus tests that we can use as an example of mm-hmm. forward-seeking democracy.
Yes.
Because if you think about it, the Kenyan election is a reflection of alliances and handshakes. Uh-huh.
Alliances and handshakes, because if you look at it, Raila Odinga makes a pact with Martha, sworn enemy and foe from times past.
Mm.
Then you have Ruto here, Musalia has come into the picture.
Who has been
you
on the
have,
other side.
Yes, Moses Wetangula, and then Kalonzo Musyoka, a few days to the election, makes the perfect alliance for 5 seats.
Yes.
I think as Ugandans, we should learn that your enemy's enemy is your friend and your friend's enemy is your, enemy. Because I mean, Mao should not be hung after all. If you think about it like that.
Yes.
Okay, so if you look at the alliances, then you come down to the election spending. Right now, one of the biggest debates that Raila puts forward is corruption. But right now, the election spending in Kenya is surpassing, it's breaking glass ceilings. Because to be president, you have to spend at least $40 million.
But one of the candidates claims to be a hustler. I don't know.
Well, he's a hustler, but he has sold out.
Where does this money come from?
Exactly. Where does this money come from here? I mean, stadiums are all packed out.
Yes.
Okay, and there's money going up. Actually, alcohol sales have gone up by about 31%, because that is the currency of trade rates.
We will get actually to that, because it's a very wide discussion of political financing and how these campaigns are financed. It's a very big discussion, not only in Kenya, but also here in the country and also in other countries. But actually, before we get into that details, there are, of course, still other updates that happened on the eve of the election. Now, Lynn Komjisha is joined by Vivian Kamsime, of course, to take us through what has happened before. And, of course, to give us a feel of, you know, what was there yesterday when Kenyans are going to the polls. And, of course, the updates, how Kenya was prepared for this election. Lean back to you.
Wonderful. Yes, yes indeed, Mubarak. Wasake there always has interesting data. Statistics. I mean, when he throws them around, you're like, okay, I get it. But Vivian, we understand that the Kenyans have gone into polls this morning, but after campaigns that were full of debates in living costs, unemployment, corruption. But what in the lead up to this day, what actually happened? What are those key issues that happened?
Of course, very many things have happened in the lead up to the election there in Kenya. We saw a number of state capture allegations with the deep state nation that, of course, Deputy President Ruto has been talking about and accusing the ruling government. Also, we saw a number of bitter exchanges between Ruto and the current president, Uhuru Kenyatta. I also witnessed the Azimio la Umoja coalition go against and after Deputy President William Ruto for his unethical ways. They branded him a land grabber. They have been targeting him for not being honest. And this was a kind of thing in the election that consistently kept on resounding from one speaker to another. Very interesting a way of how they have gone after him and how he consistently got back to the president asking him to leave him alone, to appreciate that he actually
like the hustler
him.
He is.
Yes, the president, he had supported the president to come into power, and if he's not willing to support him, it is well. He should not meddle with the succession plan in this case. So those are some of the things that happened. Also, we saw the IEBC coming under fire very many times about how its preparedness to hold a free and fair election in
That's
Kenya.
Right. That's right.
We saw the Azimio la Umoja bring up the issue of registers. Of course, the IEBC says from the previous election, because Chairman Chebukati was actually the chairperson of the IEBC then in the 2017 election, and one of the things that came up were the registers. And they said one of the recommendations was to use an electronic register against the manual register. But as Mio had insisted that they should actually use a manual register. That seemed to be sorted out when the IEBC insisted that they would use the manual register as a backup. And so there is no need to worry. Also, the other thing that came up, of course, was the election materials. There was also that cost of protecting the ballots.
Yes.
Or inspection of the ballots right from Greece. A number of observers had to go there from different parties of the observer missions or civil society organizations. From
and
the candidates, the representatives of the candidates, both mainly Ruto and Odinga's side, took people to Greece to actually inspect and confirm the ballot papers from there before they actually arrived here. It was quite a cost, by the way, talking about the cost of this campaign. And that was also quite interesting because IEBC facilitated it to allow for transparency. The Venezuelan saga.
Yes,
well,
yes.
Was quite interesting. because of course one of these Venezuelans was caught with stickers of IEBC, and there was no notification of him coming into the country.
No, that's right.
With basically private luggage and, you know, checking in, coming to Kenya.
Mm.
And then it turns out he's connected to a certain businessman, and then IEBC needs to explain, then they go into a closed door meeting and sort themselves out.
It's how these small issues come up during this period, and
yes,
they look bad on certain candidates.
That is true. But also, the other interesting aspect of this election, of course, has been the opinion polls
mm-hmm.
that were being churned out one after another. Of course, they were showing no decisive lead, and that's quite a bit of a thing.
They were also not hitting the average mark.
Exactly, yeah, the decisive lead of 50%.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, yes, as Niela Umoja was coming out with their candidate, Ruth, Raila Odinga as the top candidate, but still, he was not at the 50% mark.
Mm-hmm.
I think, of course, depending on how the Kikuyu, who are the biggest or majority voters, decide to split that vote. Plus, of course, we know that the Luya are the second largest voting bloc and all.
Mm-hmm.
We will see how that goes.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. They're saying that this is the first time in the multi-party era none of the main candidates are from the country's largest ethnic group, Kikuyu. But now, to make up for that, they know that these votes are vital. Both have chosen Kikuyu running mates. Let's talk about that. Running mates. Why are running mates very key in this election?
Of course, the running mate becomes the deputy president.
That's right.
And that is key, definitely, to the country. But what is interesting about these running mates
mm-hmm.
and the question you bring up, the question of the Kikuyu tribe,
mm-hmm.
is that it cannot be swept under the carpet.
That's true.
And while there is no candidate who is actually among the major candidates, because David Mwaure is actually Kikuyu,
mm.
the running mates, most of them, Martha Karua is Kikuyu, Rigathi Gachagua is Kikuyu, very influential in bringing a certain voting bloc
mm-hmm.
from that region, because they were actually fighting for these votes. That is why they were giving these people to become running mates.
That's right.
Mm.
Anyway, thank you very much, Vivian, for that. Back to you, Mubarak. You've had, in the lead up to today's heat, all that came into play. I wonder what data Donald has for you in that regard.
Thank you so much, Vivian, and of course, Lynn Komjisha, for that wonderful analysis. We'll get back to you in a minute, but actually I want to bring in then Mr. Isaiah and, of course, Donald. Let me start with Mr. Isaiah. We've had these events before we get to the issue of, there are two issues, the pertinent issues that are coming in from Vivian and Lynn. One is the issues to do with IEBC, whether actually it is prepared or this. You have actually had these commissions before. We want actually to understand from you, from your own perspective, these issues seem to have pinched, you know, holes in the capacity of IEBC to deliver a free and fair election in Kenya. What is your view on that?
Well, Mubarak, Vivian has put it very well that mm-hmm. there have been all these, you know, controversies, you know, people caught with bags mm. carrying electoral material at the airport
mm.
and they don't work for IEBC and they're connected to some businessman mm. in town. How that has been resolved, we really don't know. We just saw, after so many exchanges between the intelligence chief
yes.
and the IEBC chairman, you know, there was a lot of media spat
yes.
back and forth.
Mm.
And then suddenly, one day, we see them coming up in a press conference to say this has been sorted out,
mm-hmm.
everything is well.
Mm.
How they sorted it out, we don't know. But what is my reading of this? I think that something was actually happening.
Mm-hmm.
There was a plan to use these stickers somewhere, mm-hmm. and there were some designated polling stations
yes.
Where they were supposed to be going, but it was nicked in the bud by the security, the intelligence apparatus.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think the IEBC was told in no uncertain terms that mm-hmm. you are trying to, you know, play dirty. But we have found out this, if you make a misstep again, you're in hot soup.
We have had actually IEBC being in the spotlight for so many incidents, like that of the Venezuelan issues, but also, you know, other issues on the use of both electronic and manual, you know, registers. Does this actually matter as long as the election, you know, results come out?
It does matter because the understanding from the beginning was that the voting was going to be actually the registration of voters and voting was going to be through biometric, the biometric system, the KIMS kit that Kenya procured at a very high cost.
Yes.
But the manual registers were always meant to be a backup. So why do you want to use, you know, the main system and you say that the backup is not going to be used? Why don't you pair them up so that you eliminate any doubt? For example, I have just voted about an hour ago. But as after my my fingerprint was taken and I was electronically confirmed to have appeared at the polling station and taken a ballot and possibly voted, the register was also marked. So should there be any dispute after,
then
somebody can confirm that Isaiah Kojwang was actually here at 7:30, he voted, the electronic register shows that he voted, but the manual register also shows that he voted by way of a tick against his name. So, you know, supposing the manual register was not there, you know, what happens if electronic system collapses?
Yes.
Then I have not voted.
Absolutely.
And that could happen to millions across the voting areas.
I'll come back to you, Isaiah. Let me actually bring in Donald before, because there are two issues that I came out. One, the IEBC being in spotlight for so many incidents, clashing with the police, and, you know, last time we had three Venezuelans being arrested, and then the police says they were having voting materials. IEBC says these are our officials. But actually, the clash happened, and then it was resolved after. Bring in from the perspective of the voting register, does it actually matter for an electoral body like IEBC having two systems working at the same time?
Well, in form of a riddle, technology past, technology present, technology future. I mean, technology was at the center of why the election of 2017 was nullified by the Chief Justice. And I quote, he said, an election is a process and not an event. And the second round was the vote electronically manipulated for Uhuru Kenyatta. So when you bring these things into perspective, technology is at the foundation of this election, just like as it was in 2017, which I think is a step in the right direction.
Yes.
Okay. So if you have the actual register, the manual one, it's complemented by the electronic one.
Yes.
But these things here are bound to fail. And I can assure you, petitions are going to be filed because he was so lucky to have a seamless process in Kampala where there is 4G. There are villages out there where even the satellite link phones won't work, 3G or 4G internet connection is not there.
Yes.
And just the mere fact of the transparency. The IEBC and now the current law allows for parallel tallying centers. So if you have three tallying centers or four out there, and they are all churning out their results, they may not be able to announce them, but I have the mandate to have my results. Isn't that a recipe for disaster?
Exactly. Let's actually go to the issue of the IEBC being in spotlight for these events. Do they actually speak to something of a possible manipulation of the final result?
I think it's mistrust, starting from the company, Smartnik. Smartnik has been indicted for election crimes in the Philippines. Smartnik was at one point in the soup of things in Uganda. Yes, in Uganda. That's very Smartnik company there, also in Venezuela and other countries. So when you put these things together,
it's indicting.
Yes, it's indicting. And because it's technology, people will never fully accept technology right now. The processes that are being used by Kenya are maybe 10 years ahead of their time, just like they are 20 years ahead of Uganda's time. So when you put all those things there into consideration, there'll be mistrust. But at the end of the day, the one who holds the cards wins.
Of course, we will get back to that. Of course, before I go back to Vivian, they actually, and Lynn, they are actually a very interesting perspective of this. We do not have a main candidate coming in from the Kikuyu ethnic group in Kenya, and now most of them actually chose to have their running mates from the Kikuyu ethnic group. Does it actually, what does this actually signify, and does it even matter in this election, Isaiah?
Yes, Mubarak, I think it matters because if you look at it since independence, apart from the time that Kenyatta was president, of course he was the president, so it was not possible that another Kikuyu would run against him. If he did, probably as a very fringe candidate.
Yes.
During the times of Moi, there was always a Kikuyu somewhere.
Yes.
Then Uhuru comes, Kibaki comes in. Of course, he was the main guy. He is from the Mount Kenya region that is predominantly Kikuyu, and he was a Kikuyu. So even if there was another candidate, it really didn't matter. Then comes Uhuru, again from the Mount Kenya region. There may have been other candidates. They were insignificant. Kikuyus, apart from being the largest ethnic group in Kenya, are also the richest in terms of, you know, resources. They contribute a huge chunk of money to the economy. Now, when you're talking about elections, you're also talking about security.
Yes.
You're also talking about the economy. So the Kikuyus are quite concerned who becomes president.
Yes.
Just like any other tribe, but of course you'd imagine that they would be more concerned than everybody else. Now, for Raila to have chosen a Kikuyu running mate, and he was the very first among between the two top contenders to choose a Kikuyu running mate. As Donald says, Martha Karua was the arch enemy of Raila Odinga. And Martha at one point even said they did not share anything in common with Raila Odinga. But what did Raila Odinga see in Martha? Raila Odinga has picked up corruption as a main tool for a main agenda for these campaigns which have just ended. And who has, you know, almost the best anti-corruption credentials among the top politicians in Kikuyuland? It is Martha Karua.
Martha, yes.
So I think it was a perfect fit for Raila Odinga to pick on Martha Karua, you know, so that they can campaign together.
Yes.
And Martha comes up and says, it was never that we didn't share anything in common. I was a candidate and Raila was a candidate. When you're a candidate and you have an opponent, you look for any tool to throw, you know, any weapon to throw at him.
Yes, that's
and
true.
So she says, I was saying those things because he was a candidate and I was a candidate. I just wanted to get an edge, you know, above him. So what happens a few days after Raila has picked Martha Karua's running mate? William Ruto also picks Rigathi Gachagua, who is also from the Mount Kenya region. Unfortunately, Rigathi Gachagua came with, you know, a lot of question marks. And one has just been confirmed. You know, at the beginning, everything is just suspicion. Or is in court for this case of corruption, in court for, you know, obtaining money, you know, from government through, you know, dubious means. And just 1 week before end of campaigns, a court of law actually says Rigathi Gachagua is guilty. He took this money, you know, illegally from government, and therefore the money has been, you know, recovered, and now it belongs to government. So, yes, I think back to your question, it was very important that they pick their running mates from that area.
Yes.
But now you see where the departure comes.
Exactly. Let me bring in Donald before I get back to Studio B. We see this, all these candidates seem to be actually targeting that block vote of the Kikuyu land. I just want to pick your view. Actually, many of the Ugandans looked at it from the perspective of the gender balance. William Ruto picking a man and then Raila Odinga picking a female. What do you read between lines? Is it a matter of picking from the Kikuyu land or from the gender balance perspective?
Well, it's a little bit of both, but I think at the current moment, the Kikuyu line is inconsequential for any one of those parties there, because each of them, their running mates have strong credentials that they bring to the game right now. Yeah, if you think about it, like he said, corruption versus the hustler. If I am 23 years old, I am downtrodden on my luck. I am struggling in Nairobi, and I see all these rich people driving their cars, Do I care about the corruption? Maybe I don't anymore. Maybe I am a hustler and I want my piece of the cake right now.
Yes.
So maybe I am going to vote for Ruto because that's what he represents. But if I'm much older, I want to secure my wealth. I am going into a transition right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Who has eaten the most? Maybe Baba, he has been losing 4 times.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you give this guy this chance right now so he can be on his way?
Mm.
Okay?
Yeah.
But then at the end of the day, you have Professor Wajakoya, mm-hmm. who may just be the split. Because if I'm a hustler and I want marijuana to bring me more money, and I want snake venom, give me something that is not the same. I am broke right now.
Mm.
So if you put all those things in the mix, you'll find that the tribal line right now has been diluted.
Yes.
And it will come down to core issues like those.
It will come back to core issues like those. Now we actually want to find out what exactly the major issues that have been, you know, taking place in Kenya, and what are the major issues that this campaign has been riding on. Of course, we know that we have been having reports that are coming in from different media houses showing how the president, the vice president, rather the deputy president, are exchanging bitter words, you know, accusing one other of immorality and, of course, telling lies of this and that. But of course, let's first go back to Lynn Komjisha in Studio B and Vivian Kamsime to take us through what are the major events of this campaign and what are the major issues that have come out clearly that Kenyans have been looking out for these four candidates. Lynn, back to you.
Right. Thank you very much, Mubarak. Interesting conversation you're having there with Donald and Isaiah. But before we can get into that, allow me bring us up to date a little bit. Rift Valley's biggest city, Eldoret, is the front runner, William Ruto's stronghold, while the lakeside city of Kisumu is the bastion of his main challenger, Raila Odinga. Now, Ruto, a businessman from the Kalenjin tribe, is an ally turned foe of the ruling establishment. We have all those coming in. If he wins, Odinga will become the first Kenyan president from the Luo community. Did you know that?
Yes, and Lynn, that is where the gist of the matter is when we are talking about these dynasty issues.
Yes.
Isaiah was explaining to us about the Kikuyu issue playing mm-hmm. out in elections, the different political arenas
Kenya. Yes.
And is this a do or die?
You know, for Raila.
Odinga, because he has been a 5-time candidate. He came in 2002. He was on in 2007, 2013. And then, of course, the 2017 election.
Yes.
Where he definitely boycotted a rerun. And Uhuru Kenyatta took it by 98%.
That's true.
98%. So it is very interesting. And the question has been asked, is it a do or die? Because he's most advanced in age among the candidates.
I mean, and he's tired, and politically tired.
And you know, when you think about it, during their final rallies on Saturday,
yes.
Well, President Uhuru Kenyatta was in his backyard in Mount Kenya campaigning for the Azimio la Umoja candidates.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Raila Odinga was at the stadium trying to rally or make his final call to being elected. And Ruto had to go to Mount Kenya himself. He was still running around,
got
into that jet to go to Mount Kenya and give his final call there as well. And I was asking myself, does Raila have the same stamina?
Does he indeed? Does he?
Does
I don't think so. But briefly, from Narok to Bungoma and mm-hmm. Nyeri to Kiambu, voters across Kenya are voting for a new set of leaders, and that will see President Uhuru Kenyatta pave way and be succeeded after serving at the helm of the constitution he allowed maximum 2 years. I just wanted us to pick this. Kenyatta's 89-year-old mother, Ngina, is one of the voters. She's casting her ballot at Gatundu South constituency
and
in Kiambu County.
And she was backing Azimio la Umoja candidate.
Oh, see, that's very interesting. So the while speaking about issues in this campaign, in the lead up to today, the issue that sticks out for me is the dynasties versus the hustlers.
Yes.
That for me stands out. But before we can get into that, who are the key politicians, apart from these two, who are the key politicians that we should also focus our eyes on?
Of course, the running mates are key politicians in this race. Rigathi Gachagua was being talked about as one definitely who has been involved in a number of corruption scandals.
Mm-hmm.
There was that anti-corruption case where he was actually told to return about 200 million Kenyan shillings.
That's right.
Because he did not deliver the services, and yet he actually has his money on account.
Mm-hmm.
The money had been freezed, and when court sat and decided on the case, he was told to return the money. Of course, he is also a stronghold in where he comes from, in Chirinyaga, he comes from Kakamega.
Mm.
And he's strong there, he's a Kikuyu. Of course, he brings on table the Kikuyu vote. He's a rich businessman at that. And definitely such an influential one on Ruto's side. You can also talk about, of course, Martha Karua. She has been discussed by the Isaiahs.
Yes.
And of course, we know that it is actually President Uhuru Kenyatta who chose Martha Karua as his pick for the vice president's post in that agreement they have with Odinga.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, he has insisted that he chose her for her stance on corruption. And she's seen as someone who is very keen on matters of justice and human rights.
Mm-hmm.
She's a lawyer by profession. Of course, she has also served in government before. She was a minister in President Mwai Kibaki's government.
Okay.
And very interesting experience that she brings on the table with that gender-based inclusion
mm-hmm.
that we are seeing playing out in that campaign. Of course, also the other running mates in this election are the ladies, Ruth Mutua, for David Mwaure, is also a lady, and she's a Christian. The David Mwaure camp is basically about Christianity and values in society. They say they are breathing a fresh air. They are bringing a breath of fresh air into
mm-hmm.
the political arena
mm-hmm.
in Kenya. Of course, they say they have not been implicated in any way in corruption. David Mwaure is a renowned lawyer in Nairobi. And it is also very interesting how he has managed to stand out in his own corner, if you like.
Mm-hmm.
Professor Wajakoi, on the other hand, has a lady as well, who I think is the youngest. She's 35. And of course, they had a bit of a thing the other time when she was talking about supporting Azimio La Umoja candidate Raila Odinga.
Of course.
And the key politicians here also include the other players that have been going on around in their campaign.
We can look at the governorship, the
gubernatorial, for example,
the Nairobi guys and also the Mombasa people.
Of course, the issue of Sonko has been key, even in the presidential race. Because remember, at first, he was being called on by the Azimio camp to try and help Polycarp Igathi
mm-hmm.
in the Nairobi race.
Mm-hmm.
But then they fell out.
Yes.
They fell out. And towards the end, when he lost his case in court, he was feeling very bad, and he said he had to make some very serious decisions on who and he's going to support and how he'll actually be advancing the interests of his supporters. And so he crossed to Ruto's side.
Yes, yes.
And has been campaigning for Ruto, actually, or Kenya Kwanza. Very
yes,
interesting
that's
events
true.
There. He endorsed Omar in Mombasa
mm-hmm.
as his preferred choice of the governoress, of course, which has been cancelled according to IEBC reports.
Yeah, because of balloting issues.
Because of ballot issues,
yes,
the
yes.
first mix-ups and
mm-hmm.
Details there.
But the one that I'm concerned about is the Nairobi the gubernatorial race,
mm-hmm.
where the voters called them rich people who chose now to just go into the markets. I'm talking about Igathi, who cleaned toilets.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if these political gimmicks actually do, you know, play any role on the ballot.
Of course, there are stunts to try and woo people, to showing them, because he said these are jobs that have long been seen as dirty, but they're actually doable. People are actually doing them.
Mm-hmm.
And so he can. He's an elite from the corporate world.
Mm-hmm.
He has a corporate job at Equity Holdings.
Yeah.
And one would wonder, why would he come down to do this? Just to take up office. Of course, Sakaja also is not an exception. He has been seen selling vegetables.
And cooking
in the markets.
In the markets, yes.
Of course, they are key politicians, because of course the Nairobi governorate is as hot as the Kampala race here.
Absolutely.
That is the
absolutely.
Center or the capital of
Kenya. Of everything. Yeah.
Yes.
Mm.
And when we are talking about this race, we are looking at the strongholds of these two different camps between the coalitions of Azimio la Umoja and Kenya Kwanza.
Mm-hmm.
Polycarp Igathe belongs to Azimio la Umoja, and Sakaja Johnson belongs to Kenya Kwanza. So a bit of show of power there between Kenya Kwanza and Azimio la Umoja.
Before we can get back to Mubarak, Vivian, something came up and people were trying to weigh in on the two gentlemen, the two contenders, the leading contenders. And they were saying that Raila tosses himself into an arena that he will try to get the presidency and perhaps achieve his father's dream. If that, that brings us to the issue of dynasties versus hustlers. Ruto is well known as a hustler because that's, well, that's the hat he has worn. But we also understand that Raila came in, even the history that Isaiah and Donald and Mubarak have already hinted on. But this, can we, are we going to see a change of politics at play in Kenya?
Definitely, these key personalities, Uhuru Kenyatta, Raila Odinga, and Ruto, are going to continue being key in the politics of Kenya.
Even after today.
Even after today, yes. But, Lynn, to tell you the truth, as an analyst who has been following up this election, I think the candidates have been a bit unfair for the electorate. And, of course, now that the process is on, they do not have an option. Why do I have to say that? Maybe Isaiah will have to come in as a citizen and the concerned party in this issue and tell us what he actually thinks about it. But I think they have definitely been presented with, I should say, weird choices. Because in one choice, you have someone who has been part of the dynasty.
Mm-hmm.
We are talking about Raila Odinga, who has been involved through his father from the time of colonial masters. When they're talking about a deep state, they are trying to talk about the colonial systems that still run within governments that have not intentionally been actually tackled.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been part of that oil in the engine.
Yes.
And then now, the other part of the dynasty, which has been winning, or always winning, because we've seen more Kikuyus here being president and playing out in these politics at the very top. And they are the rich ones. They have lots of land, they own businesses and what. Of which Odinga is actually part. So these guys are like, we are done ruling and eating some. Now we're Yako, you know, in Luganda. So it just feels like Odinga is someone who is coming in to cement that past.
Yeah.
It's been seen as President Uhuru's legacy that he wants to take away the old drive.
The old drive, yes,
and
yes.
And keep a legacy as someone who united Kenya in
absolutely,
a way.
Absolutely, absolutely.
But when you to think about it, then that would turn come down to two tribes, the Luo and the Kikuyu. How about the rest of the Kenyans? They are the Luo, the Kalenjin.
Don't they matter?
They've been, they are part of Kenya and need to be included.
Mm-hmm.
When you take a look at the Ruto side, the hustler who is talking about himself as the right candidate to actually tackle corruption, because
and the economic crisis.
The economic crisis, because you know he has also actually accused Raila Odinga of corruption. When Raila Odinga was prime minister, some of his relatives were implicated in corruption scandals.
That's
and they've
true.
Not been resolved. So both these people have been part of this engine.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't see that different aspect of what a Kenyan is thinking of, where do I want to go next?
Absolutely.
Depending on where I'm coming from.
Yeah.
So you see the hustler nation coming out of that dynasty politics to actually want power. And really, you're seated and thinking, wouldn't there be better choices?
Oh, right.
If we had the dynasty hustler on one side and then have another
another normal person.
A future that is free of that.
Oh, free of
that. What would it look like?
What would it look like, indeed? Yeah, Mubarak, as we head back to you, I pose a question to Isaiah. In the event that we see Ruto take leadership, what does this mean for Kenya and its, you know, politics? But okay, assuming Ruto doesn't win, if Raila does, are we going to continue with the politics of dynasty against the hustlers and they take rule forever? What do you anticipate is going to change with either of the leaders?
Very interesting question there coming in from Lynn Komjich and, of course, Vivian. Thank you so much for that analysis. We'll get back to you just in a minute. This is a special edition of actually coverage of Vision Group. We are covering the Kenyan elections live and, of course, we are bringing you updates also with other platforms. Now, with me in studio is Isaiah Kojwang, of course, chairman of Association of Kenyans in Uganda. He has already just taken his vote. He has just cast his vote at the at the Kenyan High Commission here in Kampala. And of course, Donald Wasake, he's a data analyst and also a political analyst. Now, actually, there are very many issues that are being raised by the two ladies there that have been following these elections, but I actually picked three of them. I just want you to just have, you know, an analysis of exactly what we have to know about this kind of thing. One of the issues that are coming out are these accusations from one camp to the other camp. We've seen them accusing themselves of corruption, each camp, because these guys have all been in government at some point. What? Why do we actually have to have this kind of confrontation, accusations and counter-accusations? Where do Kenyans, where do these accusations leave Kenyans? Isaac.
Yeah, Barak, and as Lynn has just asked a very important question about where does the Ruto's presidency take Kenya, where would...
We'll get to that as a last one. But I just want you to pick from this, from the start, where do these accusations and counter-accusations leave the common Kenyans? Because I understand that the Kenyans have to look out for issues, not accusations of this one is a corrupt, this one is not corrupt. I don't know where this actually leaves you.
But is being called the dynasty an accusation?
Mm-hmm. And the hustler.
Do you choose where you've been born and from which parents? I think that is really a misplaced kind of notion. Mm. If Ruto's son decides to run for the next, because they're all of age, he has three sons and they're all of age. Mm. If one of them decides to run for presidency in the next elections, would he then be dynasty because Ruto has been a deputy president for 10 years? Mm-hmm. So I think that is just something that was coined to try and discredit the other side. On the other hand, these accusations of corruption, of course, are coming through. Ruto, on one side, has had accusations against him. Mm-hmm. We know that he's such an energetic person. Mm-hmm. He has made his money through the years. Some of the history may not speak very well mm-hmm. about his sources of income, because mm-hmm. remember that he was a young Turk in Moi's regime, yes. The YK-92, if you remember. Mm-hmm. But that alone, I think, does not explain how he has made his money, that he can be accused that every money that he has made has been a product of corruption. Mm. So I think making choices for Kenyans is about, I think it would be more important to see what kind of character are we
putting in office, in the first office.
And how does this augur for the future of Kenya and its economy? Mm. And I think right now, as I said before, Raila is running on the platform of anti-corruption.
Yes.
And I think he's talking also of industrialization. Mm. Ruto is talking about empowering the masses at the bottom, bringing them up. They say, life has been unfair to you all these years since independence. Mm. Why don't we create a system that gets you out of the bottom and puts you somewhere so that you can also at least afford a smile?
So
I think Kenyans have a very difficult choice, mm-hmm. And especially the youth. As you said, the youth are torn between those two candidates. I wouldn't talk about Wajakoya much because
unfair.
I think the propositions that he's putting on the table are a bit outlandish. Mm. You're talking about marijuana, which is fine. You can legalize it because I think growing
marijuana
under a very controlled
environment. And legal regime.
And I was told that 60 farmers were licensed to start marijuana farming, and out of those, only six have started.
Yes.
And I think that speaks to the cost that goes with this marijuana farming, because you're not going to grow it just in the fields.
Yes.
It has to be in greenhouses, controlled temperatures, controlled moisture, controlled pesticides, so many things. So when Wajakoya talks about it, it sounds very easy. It sounds like you know, the moment after 10th of, maybe after 9th of August, you know, we start growing marijuana and we start making billions of dollars. It's really out of this.
I'll come back to you to the other questions. But actually, I want to bring in Donald before I get back to you. Donald, we actually have issues to do with dynasties, hustlers, this kind of classification of people. But also, Kenya is the wealthiest East African nation. But actually, all of these candidates are trying to actually please the majority who are poor. That means there is quite a very big imbalance between the rich and the poor. What does actually that speak to? But we'll have submissions from you after this very short commercial break. We are bringing you Rush Hour live from Vision Group headquarters here in Industrial Area. And of course, we are giving you a 360 coverage of the Kenyan election. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We are taking a short break. We are returning in a short while. To the Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. Now, this is the special edition of a coverage of the Kenyan elections. Today, 22 million Kenyans are lining up to vote for their next president, of course, replacing Uhuru Kenyatta, whose two constitutional terms came to an end. Now, in Studio B, we have Vivian Kamsime and also Lynn Komjisha, but also here with me are two distinguished gentlemen. This is Isaiah Kojwang, Chairman, Association of Kenyans in Uganda, and of course, Donald Wasake, data analyst. Before we left for a break, we are trying to talk about dynasties and hustler nation. These two camps seem to have taken the lead in an election, but also Kenya is the richest country, rather the wealthiest country in East African community. But certainly, all these candidates are appealing for the vote of the poor, meaning actually the poor are the majority. What does this actually signify, Donald?
I think like in every society, the scales of inequality will always be unequal. Mm. Kenya, on average, loses about 2 to 3 billion Kenyan shillings in corruption, as per allegations from each of the counterparties and various researchers out there. Mm. Where is this money going to? Is it going to the rich, mm-hmm. or is it going to the poor? Mm-hmm. If you put it in that perspective there, those of the dynasty want to continue, want to rule, and want to prolong their stay in power. Mm. The hustler wants to have a dynasty. Mm. The hustler wants a seat at the high table. Mm-hmm. I am not going to be a hustler for the rest of my life.
Yes.
Okay? So if you put those things into perception, you realize that, yes, the hustlers want this, mm. but is power going to cede this? Because yes. Raila right now represents that power there, backed up by Uhuru Kenyatta. Mm. Continuation of something great. Yes, our forefathers had mistakes which they made, but maybe right now is the time to settle things down, mm. to calm things down. While on the other hand, Ruto is like, no, look, my piece of the cake, and for the rest of the downtrodden Kenyans out there, mm-hmm. the hustlers. By the way, you know, it's a very interesting thing. When Kenyans come to Uganda, they are the hustler kings. If you want a good deal, you have to go to a Kenyan. Hey, check him, man. I want you to do this and do that. So,
yes.
Mm. So if you put those things into perspective, I think it's going to be quite interesting, and mm. you have quite a number of undecided voters. Mm. For instance, in Nairobi, you might have about 405,000. Mm. Yes, it is Raila's stronghold, mm-hmm. but there are quite a number of hustlers in Nairobi.
Yes.
Then you come to places like Nakuru, mm. okay? Yes, it might be Ruto's stronghold, mm. but Raila may be cutting in. Mm. You have Kakamega, you have yes. Kiambu. So, mm. so there are quite a number of undecided voters out there mm. who are going to take this till the final moment.
Actually, Isaiah, just a comment on what does actually Ruto's presidency mean to Kenyans, because he seems to be representing the hustler nation.
Ruto's presidency, I think, would reflect on what happened in the first term of Uhuru and Ruto when they were still working together. Mm. But I want to say this about that those 5 years. Mm. If you look at even the issue of infrastructure.
Yes.
In the first 5 years, the Jubilee government built 3,000 kilometers mm. of tarmac road.
Yes.
In the second term, they've built 8,000 mm. Kilometers.
Yes.
In the first term, I think there was a bit of, there was a lot of camaraderie. They were very good friends. Mm. But I think the spirit of work was a little lacking. Mm. And I think that explains why most of the projects of the Jubilee administration have taken place in the second term. Mm. But looking at Ruto as a person, you see the energy that he has. Mm. You see how convincing he is. Mm. A lot of people, especially the young ones, and there are about 8.8 million mm. young voters, youth voters between the age of 18
yes.
and 34.
Okay. Yes, 34.
So that is a heavy.
34, yes. Mm.
34,
yes.
Yeah, mm. That is a heavy block. Mm. And he actually speaks to the youth. Mm-hmm. And that is why even the electoral sign was a wheelbarrow. Mm. You see, this is what you're doing now.
Yes.
It is not. It is not the way that the other presidential candidates have translated it.
But as this wheelbarrow is representing actually the biggest population and
exactly.
majority of the voting.
Exactly,
place.
But I think it is wrongly interpreted. No, that's not what people meant. Let's be fair to the guy.
No, actually, Lynn and Vivian also mentioned a very interesting perspective of what one of the major events that happened. We saw politicians living their luxury lives and going to the street to sell, vegetables, to clean toilets. We saw this happening with Polycarp Igathe in Nairobi and also and also Sekaja, in the gubernatorial context. What actually does that speak to? And what does this mean? Have we just gone to bastardize politics to this level?
Really? Those are just gimmicks.
It's theater.
This guy has never gone to clean those toilets. He's never going to clean them. Mm-hmm. But he just wants to say, I'm with you down here. Mm-hmm. But does that really translate into anything meaningful eventually when you vote for this guy?
I think you
should be looking at his manifesto. What does he want to do for the city?
Do the voters actually, Donald, before I get back to the
voters, actually, politics is an emotional game. Uh-huh. You might have the right manifesto, you might have everything right, but if I just don't I don't resonate with you, I will not vote you. And that's why I'm saying this stuff is at a knife's edge, mm-hmm. and Professor Wajakoya may just be the game breaker.
Okay, and then actually we'll get back to that conversation. And actually this brings us to the very, very interesting conversation. We've seen artists taking, leads in this kind of campaigns, appearing on presidential, platforms, and of course, getting into there, entertaining the voters or the supporters of these candidates. But we just want to understand, what is the role of these artists, and why are actually politicians getting to, invite these artists to come on stage, and what value do they add to their campaign? Actually, Lynn Komjisha is joined by Miles Ramiti. Lynn, just take us through, what actually does this add to, do these artists add any value to the campaigns of these presidential candidates?
Interesting question there, Mubarak. But before I can do that, it has been reported that President Uhuru Kenyatta has cast his vote at Mutomo Primary School in Gatundu South, Kiambu. Interesting updates coming in is that according to Reuters, Ruto voted at 6 a.m. in his home area of Kosekei Primary School in Sugoi. They also show that Odinga's running mate, Martha Karua, voted at Mugumo Primary School. We are seeing that poor police officers were found in possession of marked ballot papers last night, mm-hmm. and they were reportedly intercepted. An election official confirmed that materials seized were authentic and had already been tampered with. So, interesting updates coming in there. But Miles, welcome to this edition of Kenya Elections 2022. We understand artists, they not only entertain us, but they also go around trying to swing us to different camps.
Well, certainly, yes, but this has not started in Kenya here, but, even in some outside countries, of course, you look at Trump, trying to get Kanye West coming through, mm-hmm. to be on his side, people like Jay-Z as well, but the same as, of course, in Uganda here. Mm-hmm. But what we've seen in Kenya, it was different story. When Diamond Platinum posted last week on Thursday on Instagram saying I'll be in Kenya. He didn't specify whether he will be at Ruto's side or Odinga. Mm. He just said, and a lot of people thought it's going to be probably maybe a private function.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Little they know that he will turn up. Remember, Diamond has been in South Africa trying to celebrate his the birthday for his daughter with his ex-girlfriend Zari,
mm.
and he had to get a private jet to fly him from South Africa to Kenya.
Who's paying that man?
Apparently, it is said there's a businessman, a tycoon.
Okay.
A tycoon
based deep state.
A tycoon based in Tanzania, and the outgoing governor for Mombasa, Iwan Ali Hassa, who's been really trying to coordinate all this, but this tycoon, and it's funny because Diamond Platnumz to perform in Tanzania, he charges $70,000.
Mm.
But if he's to perform outside Tanzania, other places, he charges between $100,000 to $120,000.
Wow.
So, and on top of that, you have to afford his meals, and you have to get him a 5-star hotel. That is if you spend a night.
Now, with all that miles in place, what role do these artists really play in the elections?
For example, it's lately politics about the youth, and if to get the support of the youth, you need to have artists, you need to have comedians come through, you need to have people to be on your side.
Mm-hmm.
This helps, like, to get momentum, to strengthen your with your voters. So
mm-hmm.
I think that's why Diamond had to flow. But the interesting bit about it is that even when he had to go to Kenya to perform, he performed in three different phases. One, he kept on stage,
mm-hmm.
introduced the main man. You know, the guy had to campaign here and there. Then he had to come back, bring him again, and then lastly, he performed.
Interesting. Well, what a fantastic way to swing mm-hmm. the voters.
Yes, yes. And well, it is something that you believe maybe it will add value. And some Kenyan artists coming through saying, why do you have to come? We have our artists in Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
And the comedian, this Omondi, he usually uses such situations to bless this guy. He says, you know, Kenyan artists are lazy. You guys have to work hard. You understand what I'm saying?
And so, here we are saying they are better than us here.
In terms of management, being organized, they are a little bit ahead of us.
Okay.
By far,
okay.
But our people there and Kenyan artists saying, one rapper, one Julian, and of course South Solo saying, hey, why did you have to use our artists here? And the guy said, well, when I tried you were saying
you artists. All right, thank you very much,
yes,
Miles, for that update. But continuing with the latest updates coming in, is that as the voting takes place, the Washington Post has reported that the winner of Tuesday's election will have to address the country's massive debt, soaring inflation, a drought in the north that has left millions hungry, and increasing youth unemployment. Many voters are disenchanted, unsure whether either Odinga or Ruto will bring change. Mubarak, back to you. That is a question I posed earlier, and you and Isaiah been running away from it. Will either Odinga or Ruto bring change, and what kind of change will that be?
Thank you so much, Lynn Komjish, and of course Miles Ramit, for that wonderful analysis of what exactly is happening in terms of artists joining campaigns trend. But actually, we want to have a wrap-up of this. I know we have a lot that we have not touched. Lynn is posing a very interesting question, and I actually want to conclude with it. What change does actually any of the two bring to the Kenyans? But also all these campaigns, the opinion polls that we have seen, have not actually been able to show any of the candidates having a decisive win. Isaiah, let me start with you. What change does that actually bring?
I think it's all about the economy.
Mm.
Lynn has just said that Kenya is groaning under the weight of huge loans,
mm-hmm.
and that is true for many other African countries.
Mm.
Where does the Kenyan money go? The money that is borrowed is going mainly to infrastructure.
Mm.
I would only be sad if all the money was going to corruption,
mm.
and a huge chunk of it is going to corruption.
Two yes.
billion shillings a day, as Donald said, is a huge amount of money. Multiply that by 365
mm.
Days in a year is a huge loss.
Mm.
This is not just an allegation. This figure of 2 billion shillings came from the Auditor General, so
yes.
it is factual.
Mm.
Basically, what she did, she took the global loss in a year mm-hmm. and just divided by the number of days in a year, and yeah. that is how it came to 2 billion shillings.
So do these actually two candidates, either of them, may cause change in Kenya?
I think so, because they're talking about models that can each work. Mm-hmm. The bottoms-up approach that Ruto is talking about, for me, it makes sense. Mm-hmm. If you empower, you know, people exactly. at the bottom, mm. you bring them up because they're the majority anyway, yes. they're mm. the majority consumers. Mm. They would be the majority producers if they were empowered, but mm. they're not. Raila, on the other hand, is talking mainly about, you know, anti-corruption. Can we stop, you know, this hemorrhage? Can mm. we stop these 2 billion shillings going out of our coffers on a daily basis? And he's mm. talking about industrialization. You know, he's talking about bringing back cotton growing so that we can start our gineries again and manufacture our own garments. Can we have each county, because we have 47 counties in Kenya, can we have one product per county mm. out of, you know, an industrial production? So I think each of them has an agenda that can, you know, take Kenya forward.
We'll conclude with the opinion polls, but actually I want to pick your comment. What do these two candidates, either way, if they win, will they cause any change to Kenya?
I think change and believing
in if you think about it, Raila takes over, probably he brings more of the same, because he needs to protect the interests
of his predecessor.
Yes, of his predecessor. Ruto takes over, more of the same too. Mm-hmm. I have my people who are working for me, mm-hmm. I need to promote the hustlers, and yes. maybe witch hunts the dynasties. Mm. So is change really going to take place? I don't think so.
Yes.
I think it's going to be more of the same, mm. just in various versions of it. Mm-hmm. But most importantly, I think what the Kenyans out there who are watching need to analyze is, what part of the change do I need to be part of?
Opinion polls, not a single candidate. Of course, they are taking yes. Raila in the lead, but of course, without a decisive 50 plus win. What does this actually point to? Are you seeing a rerun?
I think a rerun is very likely, especially that there are quite a number of swing counties. Mm-hmm. You have Bungoma, you mm. have Kajaido, you have Kwale, you have Lamu, you have Nakuru. Mm. I mean, you have Turkana, you have West Pokot. Mm. These are more than there have ever been swing okay. counties because yeah. of the homogeneity of the voters. These 22 million voters are both hustlers mm. and dynasties, and people who are dreaming for more of the same.
Isaiah, your last comment on the opinion polls. Are we seeing a rerun here? Because we have seen tight race.
It is possible. Mm. I will not wish for it, because this
is already costing the taxpayer $347 million. Mm-hmm. It is almost unheard of in Africa. Mm. But you look at the number of positions that are being voted for, there are six. Six ballots per voter mm. times 22 million voters. Even the printing alone is very costly, but of course the other logistics. Mm. If it does happen, yes, I know that it can be managed mm-hmm. within the resources which are there, mm-hmm. But it is not anything that anyone is looking forward to.
The tension.
Thank you so much, Isaiah Kajong, the chairman of Association of Kenyans in Uganda. And of course, we wish you well back home, and of course
we hope
everything goes well. And of course Donald Wasake, a data analyst, and of course always a pleasure to have you here, and of course bringing us, you know, making sense of what exactly is taking place. Now this has been the Rush Hour, and of course it's been a special session of, and of course, the coverage of the Kenyan elections. They mean a lot to us, and of course there are key lessons to pick. We have observers in Kenya. Our own opposition leaders are in Kenya trying to take notes. And of course, even our Electoral Commission here, officials, are also in Kenya trying to take notes of experiences of the Kenyan election. Now, actually, we have to come to an end of this special coverage, but of course, normal programming is going to continue. With me has been Lincoln Jisha from the other side, and of course, Vivian Kamsime. But of course, we are running out of time. We can't move beyond this minute. We asked a question on our social media platforms. That is, of course, who do you think is going to be the next president of Kenya? And of course, you can join that conversation. Our social media platforms, it continues. And of course, tomorrow we shall bring you all the live results and, of course, updates that are coming in from the Kenyan election. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We'll make tomorrow.